Mouth matters. And if you don't believe, listen to the wisdom of toothless ones, as dentistry is not expensive, but neglect is. Hello everyone, I am Dr. Aditi, reader from the Department of Periodontology at Sri Rajiv Gandhi College of Dental Sciences and Hospital. And I will be talking on mechanical plaque control today. The focus of this presentation would be on the principles and techniques of plaque control and a special note on application of this knowledge in different clinical situations. So what are we going to learn today? At the end of this presentation, I would like all of you to know what is plaque control, the various aids for mechanical plaque control, and the choice of aid in different clinical scenarios. The contents of this presentation are introduction, history, need of plaque control, disclosing agents, aids of mechanical plaque control, toothbrushes, interdental cleansing aids, irrigation devices, summary, and conclusion. To start with, dental plaque is a bacterial biofilm which forms on all the teeth surfaces. And plaque control, it is a regular removal of microbial plaque and the prevention of its accumulation on the teeth and adjacent gingival surfaces. It is a critical component of dental practice, permitting long-term success of periodontal and dental care. The concept of cleansing aids for plaque control has been epoch-making and ever-evolving, starting from the most primitive wooden twigs, handles of oxen bone, ivory, to the presently used modern brushes. The journey is still on. Chewstick as primitive toothbrush dates back in the Chinese literature to about 1600 BC. The first patent for a toothbrush was granted to H.N. Wadsworth in 1857. Although Chinese were the first to invent toothbrushes, but it was first patented in United States. So why do we have to remove plaque? Because if left undisturbed, it can lead to a group of inflammatory conditions of the supporting tissues of the teeth that are caused by bacteria. How to detect plaque and calculus clinically? Plaque can be seen clinically by direct visual examination with the help of disclosing solutions and with the help of probes. Supragingival calculus can be seen by direct vision, subgingival with the help of tactile perception, radiographically, air blowing, and through fiber optic transillumination. What are these disclosing solutions? They are chemical compounds such as erythrosine, putsin, or a fluorescein containing dye that stains dental plaque and thus makes it fully evident to the patient either with regular or ultraviolet light. Disclosing agents are solutions or wafers which are capable of staining bacterial deposits on the surfaces of teeth, tongue, and gingiva. Solutions are applied to the teeth as concentrates on cotton swabs or diluted as rinses. Solutions and wafers are available commercially. Some of them are erythrosine, fluorescein dye, two-tone dyes, iodine-containing solutions, mercurochrome, mercurobrome, Bismarck brown. They are excellent oral hygiene aids because they can provide the patient with an educational and motivational tool to improve the efficiency of plaque control procedures. The most common aid used for removing plaque is a toothbrush. As shown in the picture, it consists of a handle, shank, head, consisting of a brushing plane with a heel and a toe. Generally, toothbrushes vary in size and design, as well as in the length, hardness, and arrangement of bristles. Today, the market is infiltrated with myriad toothbrushes, each claiming its own superiority. We can see the range of brushes from manual, powered, sonic and ultrasonic and ionic toothbrushes. However, the research does not show any significant differences in between these brushes in the gingivitis scores or bleeding indices, which are the more important measures of improved gingival health. The American Dental Association has described the range of dimensions of acceptable brushes. They say that the brush length should be 1 to 1.25 inches.
The width should be fiber 16 to 3 by 8 inches. It should consist of 2 to 4 rows of bristles and consisting of 5 to 12 tufts per row. Toothbrush bristles are grouped in tufts that are usually arranged in 3 or 4 rows. Bristles are mainly of two types, natural or synthetic. Natural are animal derivatives from hog, pig or horses, whereas synthetic consist of nylon, polyester and polyethylene. Natural bristles fray, break, soften and lose elasticity quickly, whereas nylon bristles last longer. And that's why nylon bristle brushes vastly predominate in the market as of today. Bristle hardness is proportional to the square of the diameter and inversely proportional to the square of bristle length. The diameters of commonly used bristles are 0.007 inches for the soft brushes, 0.012 inches for the medium brush and 0.014 inches for the hard brush. Bristle tip can be filament entrounding and tapered toothbrush filaments. Rounded bristle ends are least traumatic and so are preferred over the flat cut bristles, and the length of these bristles are most commonly 10 to 12 mm.
Crisscross bristle designs are available in the market, but research has proven no additive advantage over the conventional ones. Change is a way of life. Everything resists change, and so do we when it comes to changing the toothbrush. Toothbrush should be changed once in every 3 months. Bristle wear is a clear-cut indicator for changing toothbrush. We can see in the picture how the bristles are frayed. And these frayed bristles, they lead to decreased cleaning efficiency. So nowadays, in the present day, modern brushes have incorporated color indicators, which guide the user when to change the brush.
For most patients, short-headed brushes with straight-cut, round-ended, soft to medium nylon bristles arranged in 3 or 4 rows of tufts are recommended. Moving on to the electrically powered toothbrushes, which have made inroads into the dental market, these toothbrushes are not generally superior to the manual ones. They are indicated in children and adolescents, children with physical or mental disabilities, hospitalized patients, patients with fixed orthodontic appliances, uncontrolled oral biofilm and periodontal diseases, gingival recession, non-carious cervical heart tissue lesions.
These power toothbrushes are contraindicated in patients with cardiac pacemakers, children who are well-motivated brushers, and patients with severe bleeding disorders. Coming to the mechanism of action of these electrically powered toothbrushes, they were designed to mimic the back and forth brushing techniques which were invented way back in 1939. And subsequent models featured circular or elliptical motions and some with combinations. Currently, they have oscillating and rotating motions. They rely primarily on much contact between the bristles and the tooth to remove plaque. They use low frequency acoustic energy to enhance the cleaning ability. Many methods for brushing the teeth have been described and promoted as being efficient and effective. These methods can be categorized primarily according to the pattern of motion when brushing, as roll in the rolling stroke or modified Stillman, vibratory in case of Stillman, Charters and Bars, circular in case of Fones technique, vertical in Leonard technique, physiological in Smith and horizontal in Scrub technique.
The Bars method. Place the head of a toothbrush parallel with the occlusal plane with the brush head covering 3 to 4 teeth, beginning at the most distal tooth in the arch. Place the bristles at the gingival margin, establishing an angle of 45 degrees to the long axis of the teeth. Exert gentle vibratory pressure using short back and forth motions without dislodging the tips of the bristles. This motion forces the bristle ends into the gingival sulcus area, as well as partially into the interproximal embrasures. Complete approximately 20 strokes in the same position. This repeated motion cleans the two surfaces, concentrating on the apical third of the clinical crowns, the gingival sulci, and as far as onto the proximal surfaces as the bristles can reach. Lift the brush, move it to the adjacent teeth, and repeat the process for the next 3 or 4 teeth. Continue around the arch, brushing about 3 teeth at a time. Then use the same method to brush the lingual surfaces. After completing the maxillary arch, move the brush to the mandibular arch and brush in the same manner until the entire dentition is completed. The Bass technique is efficient and can be recommended for any patient with or without periodontal involvement. Modified Bass is nothing but the Bass technique with addition of rolling towards the occlusal surface.
Coming to the Stillman and modified Stillman method, the modified Stillman method requires that the brush be placed with the bristle ends resting partly on the cervical portion of the teeth and partly on the adjacent gingiva, pointing in an apical direction and at an oblique angle to the long axis of the teeth. Apply pressure against the gingival margin to produce a perceptible blanching. Then move the brush about 20 short back and forth strokes while simultaneously moving it coronally along the attached gingiva, the gingival margin and the tooth surface. A soft or medium multi-tipped brush should be used with this technique to minimize trauma to the gingiva. This process must be repeated on all tooth surfaces, proceeding systematically around the mouth. To reach the lingual surfaces of the maxillary and mandibular incisors, the handle of the brush can be held in a vertical position, engaging the end of the brush. With this technique, the sides rather than the ends of the bristles do the work. The modified Stillman method may be recommended for cleaning in areas with progressive gingival recession and root exposure to minimize abrasive tissue destruction.
Coming to the Charters method, it requires placement of a soft or medium multi-tufted brush on the teeth with the bristles pointed towards the crown at a 45 degree angle to the long axis of the teeth, as shown in the picture B. The sides of the bristles should be flexed against the gingiva and a back and forth vibratory motion used to brush. The technique was designed to gently massage the gingiva, so the bristle tip should not drag across the gingiva. The bristle tip should be placed in the pits and fissures, and short back and forth strokes should be used to clean the occlusal surfaces. The procedures are repeated systematically until all surfaces are cleaned. This technique provides gentle plaque removal. This technique can be recommended for cleaning in areas of healing wounds after periodontal surgery. Occlusal brushing. This has been advocated in all types of brushing techniques, and in this, press the bristles firmly into the pits and fissures of the occlusal surfaces and brush with about 20 short back and forth strokes. Use this technique and brush a few teeth at a time until all posterior teeth in all four quadrants are cleaned. Brushing should be done for 2 minutes ideally, and count for 2 minutes can be kept by either clock system, count system or built-in timers on toothbrush. Toothbrushing duration is said to be around 2 minutes, as there has been no significant result achieved for more than or less than 2 minutes duration. The optimal frequency for plaque removal by periodontal patients has not been determined, but it is reasonable to expect periodontal patients to completely remove plaque from the teeth at least once every 24 hours due to the patient's susceptibility to disease and complexity of the task. So, although there is no standard recommendation, but most authors recommend brushing twice daily. Overzealous brushing leads to trauma, resulting in abrasion, which is seen more commonly in the upper arch as compared to the lower arch, left side of the mouth as compared to right side in case of right-handed people, more with abrasives powder as compared to paste or gel, more in cementum as compared to dentin and enamel. And the other lesions which are observed are the gingival abrasion, gingival clefts and festoons, and gingival recession. Toothbrushes decontaminate our teeth surfaces, but how do we decontaminate them from the storage environment? So for such purpose, toothbrush caps or holders should be encouraged. 0.12% chlorhexidine spray should be used on the bristles of the toothbrushes. Before brushing, antimicrobial rinse of oral cavity is advocated, and toothpaste with strong surfactant should be used. And if we are opting for power toothbrushes, we should choose the one which has inbuilt disinfection mechanism. Toothbrushing alone is not sufficient to control gingival and periodontal diseases, because periodontal lesions are predominantly found in interdental locations as Plaque formation begins on the interproximal surfaces where the toothbrushes does not reach. So the different kinds of interdental cleaning aids are dental floss and tapes, toothpicks, interproximal brushes, and single tufted brushes. A comprehensive cleaning of oral cavity encompasses interdental cleaning. For type 1 embrasures, like in the picture A, where we have intact interdental papillae and narrow interdental space, dental floss is recommended. For type 2 embrasures, as shown in picture B, with moderate papillary recession and slightly open interdental space, interproximal brushes are recommended. And for type 3 embrasures, as shown in picture C, where there is complete loss of papillae and wide open interdental space, we recommend unitufted or end-tufted brushes. The thumb rule is, more the space, the bigger diameter interdental aid should be used. Given a clinical scenario with tight interdental contacts, which type of aid should be prescribed? For them, dental floss is the most widely recommended tool. It removes plaque from the proximal tooth surfaces. Recommendation about type of floss should be based on ease of use and personal preference. Dental flosses are available as multifilament and monofilament, twisted and non-twisted, bonded and non-bonded, waxed and unwaxed, plain and flavored, recent mesh or gauge type. In a clinical scenario where patients have low manual dexterity, where they cannot floss, or they're handicapped and hospitalized patients, then what should we do? For such patients, flossing is facilitated by using a floss holder, which can be reusable or disposable floss tool, which come as pre-threaded ones. Even power flossing devices are also available for the same. Flossing can be done either by spool method or loop method. Spool method. The technique of flossing is simple. The floss must contact the proximal surface from line angle to line angle to clean effectively. It must also clean the entire proximal surface and not just be slipped apical to the contact area. Start with a piece of floss long enough to grasp securely. 12 to 18 inches is usually sufficient. It may be wrapped around the fingers or the ends may be tied together in a loop, as in case of loop method. Stretch the floss tightly between the thumb and the forefinger or between the forefingers and pass it gently through each contact area with a firm back and forth motion. Do not snap the floss past the contact area because this may injure the interdental gingiva. Once the floss is apical to the contact area between the teeth, wrap the floss around the proximal surface of one tooth and slip it under the marginal gingiva. Move the floss firmly along the tooth up to the contact area and gently down into the sulcus again, repeating this up and down stroke several times. Then move the floss across the interdental gingiva and repeat the procedure on the proximal surface of the adjacent tooth. Continue through the whole dentition, including the distal surface of the last tooth, in each quadrant. And when the working portion of the floss becomes soiled or begins to shed, move to a fresh portion of floss. This is a picture of the loop method where the floss is tied in the form of a loop. Zealous snapping of floss through contact areas creates proximal grooves in the gingiva, which are called as floss cuts, which is seen in the picture, and these floss cuts are because of the faulty flossing technique. Now, given a clinical scenario where a patient comes to us with moderate papillary recession, so what should we do? Interproximal brushes. They are inserted through the interproximal spaces and moved back and forth between teeth with short strokes. They can clean into concavities and grooves on exposed root surfaces which are not accessed by floss, which can only clean the flats and convexities. These interdental brushes are available in various diameters and with various color codings for different types of contact areas, and they are recommended for orthodontic patients also to maintain their oral hygiene. Coming to the wooden picks or the toothpicks, these wooden tips are used either with or without handle. Soft triangular wooden picks or plastic alternatives are placed in the interdental space in such a way that the base of the triangle rests on the gingiva and the sides are in contact with the proximal tooth surfaces. The pick is then repeatedly moved in and out of the embrasure, removing soft deposits from the teeth and mechanically stimulating the papillary gingiva. Now, there is a clinical scenario where we get crowding, furcations, embrasures, areas distal to last molar or diastema, or large irregular concave tooth surfaces adjacent to wide interdental spaces for surfaces which are not accessible with larger brushes and dental prostheses. So in such scenarios, which aid should we recommend to the patient? For such situations, end tufted brushes or single tufted brushes will be the choice of aid. Now, a clinical scenario of orthodontic patients with poor oral hygiene, what should we prescribe? And even for the prosthetic patients who are with crowns and bridges, if they come to us, what is the aid of choice? Superfloss. It is the aid of choice for such scenarios. It is ideal for cleaning braces, bridges, and wide gaps between teeth. Its three unique components, as seen in the picture on the right-hand side, it has a stiffened end dental floss threader, a spongy floss, and regular floss. All work together for the maximum benefits. The maintenance of tongue holds the key for comprehensive oral hygiene practice. The main intention of tongue cleaning is to remove the debris from the dorsum of the tongue without damaging the papillae by zealous tongue cleaning. Tongue cleaning can be done with the help of toothbrushes as well as tongue scrapers. Tongue scrapers come as metallic as well as plastic. Coming to the irrigation devices, the oral irrigation systems have evolved to be a gentle yet complete oral hygiene maintenance package. It works by directing a high pressure, steady or pulsating stream of water through a nozzle to the tooth surface. They clean the non-adherent bacteria and debris from the oral cavity. There are five reasons which we can tell our patients to incorporate water flossing into their daily dental hygiene routine. They are: it saves time, easy to use, removes plaque, gentle on dental work, and reduces inflammation. These irrigation devices have been classified into supragingival and subgingival. Irrigation with a standard jet tip is called a supragingival irrigation, which is generally used for full mouth irrigation. And irrigation with a soft site-specific tip is often called a subgingival irrigation, which is generally used for localized irrigation of a specific site such as a deep pocket, furcation, implant, or crowns and bridges. There are two types. One is a professional delivered irrigation, which is done in the dental office, and the other is a home use irrigation, which is done by the patients at home. Three factors play important role in this irrigation system, that is the penetration of the solution, the concentration of the solution, and the duration for which it is used. The most effective settings are 1200 pulsations per minute with a pressure setting of 50 to 90 pascals. Talking about the professional irrigation, which is being carried out by the dentist in the dental office. Here, it is mainly done with the help of a solution containing some antimicrobial agent, which has been shown to provide some site-specific therapy. It is performed by aiming or placing the irrigation tip into the periodontal pocket, attempting to insert the tip at least 3 mm. This is achieved by using a cannula, and the irrigation which is performed in the dental office is called as lavage, or flushing of the periodontal pocket. Coming to the home irrigation, which is done by the patients at home, and the device which is most commonly used for this purpose is called as water pick. The common home use irrigator tip is usually a plastic nozzle with a 90 degree bend at the tip, which is attached to a pump providing pulsating beads of water at speeds regulated by a dial. Patient should be instructed to aim the pulsating jet across the proximal papilla, hold it there for 10 to 15 seconds, then trace along the gingival margin to the next proximal space and repeat the procedure. By the time the patient has irrigated all the proximal spaces in the full dentition, the irrigator reservoir will be empty. The irrigator should be used from both the buccal and the lingual surfaces. This cleaning must be done by leaning across the sink because water will drip down the patient's arm. Patients with gingival inflammation usually start at a lower pressure and then can increase the pressure comfortably to about medium as tissue health improves. Some individuals like to use this device on the highest pressure setting with no reported harm, of course. And patient comfort should be the guide for the pressure setting. Finally, to conclude, reinforcement of daily plaque control practices and routine visits to a dental office for maintenance care are essential to successful plaque control and long-term success of therapy. When encountered with weird clinical scenarios where conventional plaque control measures fail, the clinician should be equipped with good knowledge to handle them. I hope this presentation has thrown adequate light on such scenarios, which can be of immense help for the clinicians as well as their patients. So some of the frequently asked questions from this chapter are: define plaque control and describe the various methods of controlling plaque for a long essay of 10 marks. For 5 marks, the questions which have been asked are the interdental aids and the brushing techniques. And for very short answer, for 2 marks, the questions have been asked as disclosing solution and types of embrasures. I have dealt in detail with about all these questions in this presentation. For any more further queries, you can always contact me. My mail ID is given below. Thank you.